Coming up next, In Your Dreams.
Hello, everyone. It's great to be with you today. Thank you so much for tuning in. I'm your host, God's Girl, and you're listening to In Your Dreams. In Your Dreams is a Christian dream interpretation show, and it's good to be with you today. Karina called from Norfolk, Virginia today, and she gives us a great testimony. She's actually been learning about dream interpretation recently, and she discovered a revelation about who she was and something she was struggling with in her dream. But you know what the great part is? The revelation is good, but what's even greater is the power of Jesus Christ through his blood and sacrificial death that set her free. She used her authority and God blessed her, and she's walking in her freedom. Stay tuned. It's dream time. Welcome to In Your Dreams, Karina. Thank you for calling. How are you today?
I am well and excited to be on the show.
I'm excited to have you on the show. I love talking about God. I don't know about you, but I do know about you. Because, well, I guess that's a perfect chance to tell everybody. You took the dream class at New Life Providence, actually the last two that I've taught. And so I'm not trying to lift you up. I'm trying to lift up God. You are an example of, I believe, that has learned about this dream information and taken it. And how can I say this? Followed through. I believe you've dotted most of your I's and crossed most of your T's. I saw you bring in your dream journals typed up. I did that at the beginning too. And you had all your ducks in a row. You were at every class, I believe, with the exception of maybe one or two. But I've seen and I've heard how you're taking this information and how you're applying it to your life and your walk with the Lord. And I'm seeing you having successful dream interpretations. Would you agree?
Yes, I'm getting better. I'm improving.
And you know, it does take a while. You know, I'm sure that there are some that, you know, stump you. There are some that still at times stump me that take a little bit longer thought than the rest or meditation or prayer. But nevertheless, the couple that I have dealt with you on, it's like, it's actually very rewarding from a teacher's perspective. It's like, wow. You know, she's getting it. She's doing it. God is speaking to her through her dreams, and it's exciting. And so that's, on my end, what I saw benefiting from the dream classes. How do you feel like this dream class, or learning about dreams and the way God speaks to us in symbolism, has changed your life or your walk with the Lord?
I think it really enhanced my cultivation of my inner life.
Okay.
And what's coming to mind right now is a verse in the Bible that says, "Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it flow the issues of life."
Mm-hmm.
And I'm finding that a lot of times my dreams are kind of a mental and emotional and spiritual landscape. They reveal to me my heart condition. And so I feel like I make faster progress through some of my besetting sin patterns and other things that are troubling me, because I'm also doing spiritual homework at night, and
mm-hmm.
it's a kind of exciting way to do spiritual homework. It's different than just ordinary reflection. And another thing that's really happened a lot due to the dream class, I believe, is that I'm noticing that I personally am having more prophetic dreams. And what I mean by that is that my dreams tend to, every now and again, predict something that will happen in 24 to 72 hours.
Mm-hmm.
And that, to me, is really exciting. If I can get a handle on interpreting those in advance, some of them will probably allow me to ward off the adversary,
mm-hmm.
if there is, for example, an attack coming, or they fortify me to handle whatever is coming. And so that part has been, I think, most dramatic for me.
Mm-hmm. And it may not even be so much as it may be true that, yes, you know, you are getting foreknowledge, but I think a lot of times just that God may be trying to speak to us, but if we didn't understand his language, then we didn't get the message. So how can you know the message in order to know that something's coming if you can't read the language? So I think that there are multi-benefits of knowing how to read God's symbolism. It changed my life, and I'm very thankful for it. A lot of people are saying, God, talk to me, you know? He's like, I'm speaking in pictures. But sometimes we just don't understand how to read them. So I would just encourage people to actually be able to learn how to listen to their dreams and understand their dreams. And I think that they would find, as I have learned, that you get a lot more messages from the Lord than we're thinking that we are. Some people are thinking that he's silent, but he's not being silent. He's just not speaking in an audible voice, or he may not be speaking through the preacher at that particular time. He may be speaking to us through our dreams. I see that that's what he's done with you, because we're going to talk about one dream that you had. But first of all, this dream has some type of warfaring spirit or something you've been dealing with. I just want to say a short little prayer before we start, okay?
Yeah.
All right, God, Lord, we just come to you, Father. Lord, we thank you, Father, for your voice. No matter how you choose to speak to us, through an impression, Father, through a dream, through a vision, Father, through the preaching of the word, God. God, we thank you for every avenue that you use, Father, and we don't take any of them lightly, God. But, Lord, right now, Father, this particular dream that we're going to discuss happens to have a negative enlightenment of the enemy, Father. And, Lord, we just don't want to give him any glory. God, we want to give you all the glory. We want to thank you ahead of time, God, Lord, that she was victorious in this particular part of her life, Father. And, God, we just ask that your Holy Spirit, Father, God, would be here, Father, God, on our conversation, Lord, and would just help us, Father, God, Lord, to magnify you, God, and not the problem. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Oh, welcome, Holy Spirit. We welcome you, Lord. You're welcome here.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
Amen. I feel his presence.
I do too.
Thank you, Lord. Okay, so I'm glad you're interpreting your dreams, and or at least even if you get a part of them, you're getting more than you had before as far as being able to understand how God uses dreams to communicate to us. And so I wish you much more success, and not only success in your dream interpretation, but how you're going to help others and how you're going to share with others and they're going to learn from you. I just know that there are great aspirations in this area for you. I just feel it deep down in my soul, girl.
Okay.
So you better receive that.
I receive it now.
If you don't, I hit you over the head with it. Okay, praise God. All right, so the email you sent me was about a dream that you had several days ago. And I just want you to give us a short synopsis of the dream, and then we'll talk about its interpretation in a minute. So you're on the cliff, you're trying to get down off of a rope ladder, right?
Correct. Somehow I'm trying to escape something, and it's not clear in the dream what it is I'm escaping, but I'm in escape mode, and I reach the end of the cliff, and there's this rope ladder that is hanging off the end of the cliff, and I descend on the rope ladder expecting to be able to get onto another level of ground.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens is I find that the rope ladder just ends in empty space.
Mm-hmm.
So that planned escape didn't work for me, and I scramble back up the rope ladder. And then what happens is a man who I cannot identify, he's not familiar, also descends the rope ladder after me, but he slides down it so quickly that it's almost as if he's airborne. He has kind of got this like slippery contact with the rope ladder, and at the very end, when he reaches the end of it, he does a backflip, and it looks like he's wrenching his shoulders, but he lands smack dab in the middle of Lily Pond.
Mm-hmm.
Flowers and everything, and I think to myself, why wasn't that pond there when I went down?
Mm-hmm.
And then I don't give it any thought, and I cross a backyard and enter through the back door of a house, and this is a house I do not recognize, not familiar, and inside the house there's this low-key party in progress, and people are kind of milling around. It's not a wild party, it's just very casual and very downplayed.
Mm-hmm.
And as I'm passing through the living room, my eye catches a television set, and there's a movie playing on it, and I'm apparently it's in progress, and I catch that movie right in the middle, and there's this really creepy scene where the main character is standing there, and right beside the main character is this ghoul in a very kind of friendly, familiar position, sort of sidling up right beside the main character.
Mm-hmm.
And it all looks fine, except this ghoul has his hand above the main character's head, and his fingers are spread wide, and he's making these really bizarre, eerie movements with his fingers. They're like wriggling, creeping, crawling, clawing type movements in the space above the main character's head. And at that point, you know, my dream character says, "Hey, wait a minute, I don't like this. What is this, some kind of a horror movie?"
Your dream character is you.
Yeah, my dream character is me.
Okay.
At that point, I notice that I'm cold and wet.
Mm-hmm.
Almost as if I had been the person who fell into the lily pond.
Mm-hmm.
And I decide to take a shower, and I make an announcement to everyone that we should pause the movie and everybody should take a shower. And so everyone beats me to the shower stalls, and I'm waiting there to take a shower.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the end of the dream.
And you said in the email that you felt as if it was unfair because it was your idea to take a shower, and
right.
you got all these people that were just hanging out in front of you taking
right.
a shower,
right.
and you're having to wait.
Right. Yeah, they kind of stampeded in front of me, but I guess it was my own fault for having advised everybody to take a shower. I was standing there shivering.
Okay, now what did I teach you in the dream class? We don't add or take away from the dream.
Okay.
Okay, it's very important to keep the storyline to the storyline.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm just going to give you some tips here while we're still walking through it. Okay, so first scene is you're trying to get down off of a cliff on a rope type ladder. You can't get down. Some man comes down, slips, kind of goes airborne, falls on the lily pad. You're wondering, how come that lily pad pond wasn't there for me? And then the second scene, you come through across the backyard, come in, some people are hanging out, having like a low-key party. You see a horror movie on TV. You see two images of a main character and a goal. The goal's looking like he's kind of putting the hex or the whammy or whatever on the main character over top of his head, clawing and scratching. And then you're like, what is this? And you discover then you're cold and wet. You suggest everybody takes a shower. They go to the shower, you're left waiting to take a shower, and it kind of seems unfair because it was your great suggestion.
Correct.
Okay, cool. All right, so I noticed that you had added a couple things while we were talking, and that's great. You always get more insight. That's why it's really hard to do dream interpretations over email, but that's cool. So your interpretation of the first scene is, I'm dying to say the punchline.
Okay.
You're at the end of your rope.
Yes, yes.
Symbolic for climbing down the ladder, trying to escape, you're at the end of your rope.
Correct.
And okay.
And it's kind of a cliffhanger scenario because I'm in agony of suspense as to how it's all going to turn out. It'll probably be helpful at some point for me to share details of my life that relate to it. But yeah, I'm at the end of my rope.
I'm going down. Mm-hmm.
It's a cliffhanger situation.
Okay. All right, so that's the first scene. The second scene you attribute to symbolic for?
Discovering a creep show, I think, kind of identifying some kind of a evil spiritual activity.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And you're attributing that in real life to it going on in your life?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
There's definite correlation between that horror movie and my real life.
Okay. So you're attributing the symbolism for seeing the horror movie on TV as something spiritually evil, you're the main character, or you're getting like a foresight or a vision of it that's trying to control your mind.
Yeah.
Okay. And you decide everybody needs to take a shower because you're cold and wet. And then you're left standing waiting for a shower. And what's your interpretation of that last part?
I probably didn't interpret it entirely correctly, but what I got out of it was that a shower is represents a cleansing process,
mm-hmm.
A removal of filth, a purging. Now, I'm in the dream, I'm not actually taking the shower, but I'm anticipating taking the shower.
Mm-hmm.
And in real life, I had a cleansing process. I had a purging. I had a removal of filth.
After the fact.
Yeah.
Okay, good. All right, so give us now the details on the dream and its interpretation.
Okay.
Where at in your life, did you go through the steps that we talked about before you interpreted this dream?
I have to admit I didn't.
It's very important.
Okay.
Because I'll tell you why.
Okay.
You're saying that the dream is, you think it's prophetic, and I don't necessarily think it's prophetic. I think that it's reflecting, the first two scenes are reflecting your past. I think if you were actually in the shower, mm-hmm. being cleansed, mm-hmm. then it would be prophetic.
Okay.
But you were still waiting to get cleansed. It ended with you not being cleansed, right?
Yes.
Okay. And the day that you had that dream, you hadn't had the experience, the supernatural experience in prayer yet, right?
Correct.
Okay. So do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah. Although I do think, I don't know if prophetic is the right term to use, but in some ways the dream was pointing to a future occurrence, something that that transpired within 24 to 72 hours after I had the dream, which was that I just as the dream character recognized that there was a horror film going on in real life, mm-hmm. I recognized that there was activity of an evil spirit going on in my life, and
mm-hmm.
I was, you know, correctly identifying it as a creep show.
Mm-hmm. And that's good. And the dream does give revelation
mm-hmm.
to you
mm-hmm.
from your subconscious and brings it into your conscious.
Okay, but that's not necessarily predictive.
But that's then. Not necessarily prophetic when we talk about predicting.
Okay.
So it does show you a picture of you. You read the symbolism and you figured out what the picture meant. And then you go, aha.
Gotcha.
Okay. So that is revelation.
Okay.
And it's information. But it's not necessarily, if the dream would have had you in the shower, because you still had a choice up until the day that you dealt with it, with the next subject we're going to talk about, with your thoughts on that bridge. You still had a choice whether to change your thinking or whether to continue to be under the submission of
okay.
those thoughts. You see what I'm saying?
I do see what you're saying.
So it's
yeah.
very important when you're going through a dream, you always want to do checkpoints. Is this something I knew of in real life? Okay, this isn't something I knew of in real life, so God is showing me this, okay? But you want to say, am I cleansed in real life? You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
No, you're still under the influence. You're waiting. So the Holy Spirit could show you being in a place of waiting until His time,
mm-hmm.
but that time could have been, you know, 10 years from now. But it just so happened that it was 2 days after.
Yeah, it's a really good distinction you're making. I had misapplied the term prophetic.
And that's okay. Yeah. Just always check with yourself. Is this true in real life? Yet. Does the dream show it being true in real life yet? Yes, it is true. I'm still waiting because I haven't been cleansed. If I have identified, whether it's through a dream or whether it's identified through the word or whether it's identified through somebody telling you, whether it's identified through an impression in your spirit, is it true that I've been cleansed, okay, from the spirit?
Yeah, I'm following you, yeah.
Okay, all right. So you have this dream and you wake up and you interpret it to the best of your ability.
Mm-hmm.
I give you credit and kudos for that. Praise God, the Holy Spirit, along with the interpretation skills in you. It's a miracle, really, in a sense, to even be able to identify what the dream subject is about.
Yeah, I... Well, it is kind of surreal, and it takes a while to learn your own
yeah.
picture vocabulary, I think.
So you wake up and you're like, you don't go through the steps, which that's, in my opinion, that's not good, but you got some, and you the way that you got it could be your way, but there's a safety guard in going through the steps.
Okay.
The safety guard in going through the steps is that it will confirm or even reinforce what you may already think it's about, okay? So in your life, you're attributing this particular dream to a spirit of fear that you had, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the part of the warfare part that you saw through the dream and its interpretation. Okay, but in the part where you're at the end of your rope
mm-hmm.
and you're trying to escape and it's a cliffhanger, mm-hmm. what part of your life would that be talking about?
I had been struggling with some significant financial issues.
Mm-hmm.
A number of impossible bills were all coming due at the same time. I had, it was tax time, and I had gone to a tax preparer and discovered that even though I had been paying estimated quarterly taxes, I still owed the IRS $1,100, and I owed the state government $400. And it just so happened that in a month's time, I also had to get my driver's license renewed, my malpractice liability insurance renewed, my termite contract renewed, I had to get my car maintenance. I mean, it was just like all of these extra bills on top of the mortgage and the utilities. Mm-hmm. And so I was basically panicking, and that's where I felt like I was at the end of my rope. Mm-hmm. I just had no idea how I was going to accumulate all this money in short order to, mm-hmm. to pay all these debts and bills. And it was kind of a cliffhanger. I was in agony of suspense. Lord, how are you going to come through?
Mm-hmm.
And I felt like I was going down, 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 down. So that's the symbolism for me, or that's the connection to my real life.
Right. Can I ask you, has this ever happened to you before, financially?
I'm not quite sure how to answer that. I did have, I could have had a crisis after having graduated from school, which mm-hmm. my mother averted.
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps I could say yes to that, but
because in the dream, and I didn't plan to go here, but mm-hmm. I feel like the Holy Spirit might want to bring more light to it.
Okay.
In the dream, the masculine figure, the man,
mm-hmm.
which I think you have a masculine side to you.
Oh, I sure do.
And I definitely do as well. I think that that masculine, the man, is you.
Yeah.
He fell. The lily pad was there for him.
Yeah.
Which, what's the lily? Lily of the Valley. What's the lily pad to you? I mean, I don't want to give you my symbols, but to me, I see it as a Christ pond. What does it mean to you?
I love, I love lotus ponds and lily ponds.
Well, lilies also too represent Easter, don't they?
I guess they do, yeah.
I mean, I'm just throwing out ideas.
Huh. Yeah. I usually associate ponds with tranquility.
Okay.
Yeah, very, very, you know, blissful, tranquil scene. And actually, that is totally resonating with me, that male character is me and that I've been here before. Only the last time this happened, there was saving grace. And
that's the lily pond.
Yeah, let me tell you what it was. It's pretty dramatic.
Do you see how what you're saying now is putting this
yeah.
present man with the past man together, a past part of you?
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah. So the past that relates to is when I graduated from school, about 7 years of higher education, I was in debt about $60,000, and my mother discharged all of my school loans.
Mm. Oh, praise God.
Unbelievable.
What do you mean she discharged? She paid
it? She remitted them. I'm sorry. She remitted the debt. She paid it off in full.
Oh, my goodness.
All my school loans.
So in the dream, you're wondering, what a testimony. Thank you, God, for mothers.
Yeah.
Happy Mother's Day.
My mother.
It's not even Mother's Day yet. But in the dream, you're with that part. That part got saved. And you're wondering why. How come that salvation, that pond, that soft saving grace isn't there for me now?
Mm-hmm.
In real life, have you wondered why your mom isn't helping you now?
Well, I deliberately don't want to tell her because I've relied on her, I think, in the past. That, by the way, the remitting of the school loan was a total surprise. It came out of the blue. It was completely initiated
blessing
by her.
Blessing of her heart, yes.
I wasn't soliciting her help or anything. But I really am at a point in my life where I want to kind of detach from my mother's provision, because she has been, that's one of the ways she shows me love.
Mm-hmm.
And there's almost been an expectancy on my part over the years that, oh, you know, worst case scenario, there is mother.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I've overly relied on that, but I really want the Lord to establish the work of my hands, and I want to have a direct connection. Well, I have a direct connection with him, but you know what I mean. I want to really see him as my source,
mm-hmm.
not indirect, you know.
And I understand that. You know, I've always got something to say. I usually save the counseling part for the end, but do you mind if I tell you or answer to that?
Sure.
I mean, do you have a choice, really?
I don't.
It's my radio
choice.
Show.
Sure.
I'm just kidding, but I'll respect your boundaries if you don't want me to respond.
No, I want you to. I love your advice. You've helped me on more than one occasion.
Okay. I understand how you feel about you wanting God to establish the work of your hands, and that's very admirable. And I think that your heart is right, because you're not trying to intentionally take or try to manipulate or trying to work or trying to, you know, live off of them. And God can establish the work of your hands. But this is what I've been taught, Your parents are the representation of God while you're on this earth. The parents are the ones that are supposed to pour into you and sow into you and show the love of the Father in your life. They are your covering until you're married. And I know that you're at a certain age to where you're old enough, but I had to go through that. You know, I'm like, God, I know exactly what you're talking about with all these bills. My car has been repossessed by not being able to pay my car payment. I owe money to the IRS and I'm getting it paid down. I've been through a lot financially to where my appointments as a hairdresser have downscaled majorly. The economy is bad, but thank God the righteous are in a different category and God is able to prosper us in the midst of the storm. But nevertheless, I had to go to my parents for finances. And, you know, I came to understand the fact that they are God's extension to me while I'm on this earth. And sometimes we need to go to them and sometimes we don't. But if we need to, just as your Heavenly Father loves you and He wants to provide for you and give to you, they are His source to give to you.
Yeah.
And then I believe when He brings a husband along, then the husband will take that role. So I would totally say something different if you were like going, you know, well, you know, my parents can hook me up anytime. You know what I mean? Because that's like the wrong attitude. But I think that your attitude is right. I think it's admirable. But you don't want to cut off God's source of blessing because it's not the way that you're choosing to be taken care of. You might say, well, God, I want this over here. This is the way I want you to bring the blessing. And He might say, well, I've provided for you over here. So I think that you should reconsider. And if your parents have the money to be able to help you, I mean, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. What they have, they're just stewards over it. It came from God anyway. So if you get in the position, and of course, pray about it, but if you get in the position to where you have to lean on them, don't be embarrassed and don't be, God may be, He just may be the person that they want to use. He may not choose to use your job.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's great, but you just may not be where He wants you to be right now. And in the sense that God, when that happened with me, God was bringing me more into ministry. And so for me to go out and to work, you know, full time and to serve my job, I think would have been wrong because I knew that God was starting to cut that down. I'm not saying that's the case for you, but He started to make a transfer with me. So me actually getting more work would have taken me off of the focus of ministry, and I wouldn't have had time to do any ministry. So there was a time for the shift. You don't know if He's got your husband around the corner, you know, 6 to 8 months from now. He may be shifting you, you just don't know it. So I'm not saying, you know, we need to work, but it depends on where we're at each in our own different times as far as where God has us. So just don't put God, you know, in a box and say, okay, I want it this way. Because
yeah.
He may choose to bring it that way. So keep that in mind. And I've been there, done that. I know exactly what you're saying. It's embarrassing. It's burdensome. You know, this is a financial test that the sooner, I told you on the email, the sooner you learn the lesson to trust. You know, he heard the saying, beggars can't be choosy.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've been in a begging spot before. I have. And it's humbling. And what God has taught me through being in that spot is, you know what, Missy? You don't have any power of how much comes in your hand. You can't make a dime unless I let you make it.
Mm.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You don't have any power.
Yeah.
I'm not saying we don't through Christ, but you can have nothing unless I give it to you.
Yeah.
And the reason why He taught me that lesson was because when I get where it is that I'm going, He's taking me, He won't let me take any credit for it. No matter how big or how little credit. He wants me to know who's boss, who passes out the blessings, and He wants me to see that during this time that He can bring in resources. He used one girl to give me food. He used my parents to bless me with money. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
He used another man, one of my clients, to pay off my loan so I could get my car back. And you can't pick and choose who He wants to use because different people have different gifts. And in some people, I believe these people needed to sow into my life. And there are people that we're called to sow into their life. So, you know, let people sow what they can sow. And I would praise the Lord. Praise the Lord that they see your value, you know. I'm sure your mom and dad don't want you to be suffering, you know, when they know that they have the power to help.
Yeah.
And they need you to sow into your life.
Well,
more.
Yeah.
That's good. We'll be right back after this short break.
Check it out, y'all. Get up! Get up! Get up!
I'm sure your mom and dad don't want you to be suffering, you know, when they know that they have the power to help.
Yeah.
And they need you to sow into your life because we don't know what God's requiring of them.
Yeah, my mother and father are divorced, and my father, who is the spiritual of the two, has said to me on occasion that I ought to be more forthright with my mother because that's one of the ways that she can really receive a blessing from the Lord by sharing her love with me. That's one of her love languages.
Yeah, she's a giver.
To give materially, and she also has service as a love language.
Givers have to give.
Yeah.
It's in them. So anyway, so we'll just leave that alone. You can meditate on that, okay?
The only problem, though, with my mother is that she would, if I gave her the honest truth, she would start worrying about me. She is a hellacious worrier.
Well, you know what? She has to deal with that with the Lord because God's told her not to worry.
Yeah, I know.
It's a command. So don't be so protective, you know. Just be yourself. It's your mother and daughter, you know, your family. Family's required to help family.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, I love you, too. Okay.
I'm squirming now.
That's okay. That's okay. I don't mean it as a rebuke. I just mean it as a different point of view.
Yeah, no, I think it's a hurt, actually. And I did, to vindicate myself here, I did notify my father, and he and my stepmother sent me $500 to help cover some of the expenses. And I've gotten one windfall, which is a royalty check came in the mail. I don't have all of the bills covered. The deadline is still approaching, but I've had a good number of them covered.
Mm. Praise the Lord. I'm going to tell you what. I let my IRS bill lapse, and they'll tack on 35%.
I know.
So humble yourself.
Yes.
And ask your mom if you need to, because it'll be worse off later.
Yep.
And I've had my account levied by the IRS, too.
Oh, my God.
I'm just telling you. When I got your email, I praise the Lord. I mean, he's come through for me. It wasn't the way that I wanted him to, but I've been through it with this. So that's what I'm just trying to let you know. I can identify with you. I'm not speaking out of ideology. I'm speaking, or philosophy. I'm speaking out of experience.
Yes.
So I would ask your mother if you could. All right. So after this dream, you're walking down the street. You're going for a walk, right? Is it a prayer walk?
Yeah. We didn't do part two. Does that matter?
Part two?
Oh, yeah, I guess we're getting to that.
Yeah, this is where we're at.
Okay. I'm sorry.
Everybody, meet Karina, host of In Your Dreams. I'm just playing with you, girl.
Rewind.
Yeah, so you're going for a walk, and you've already interpreted your dream and mulling over some things, and I guess you're praying, and it's in your spirit about the dream.
Yeah.
And God reveals to you, well, first of all, as you're walking on an area that you know this area. And you look across and you see a bridge, right? Mm-hmm. And what do you think when you see the bridge? How does the enemy start attacking you? Okay. And this is a parallel to the second part of the dream, the second scene of the dream with the monster, with the ghoul.
Right. Okay. What happens is I'm at the halfway point of my prayer walk. It's the turnaround point, and I'm looking out at a beautiful scene. It's actually very picturesque. There's a river. There's an overarching bridge, and there's a yacht club. And I think to myself, oh, how lovely. Then I notice, you know, the bridge, and I think to myself, oh, that's the route I take to go to and from the chiropractic clinic where I work. And I commute over that bridge all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And then the devil insinuated a thought in my mind, which was, oh, you remember that bridge in the Midwest that collapsed last year.
Mm-hmm. In Minnesota, right?
Yeah, I think it was in Minnesota,
mm-hmm.
You know, and a lot of people were tragically killed, the people who were driving over that bridge. And no sooner did that thought enter my mind, this film played in my mind, and I saw a car plummeting from the bridge into the water below, and it was submerged in the water, and then there was the camera view shifted to the back seat of my car. It was a backseat passenger's view of me in the driver's seat, frantically rolling down my window, and this huge volume of water gushing in the side. And I, because of the momentum of the water, I couldn't escape.
Mm-hmm.
It was a real panic scene. It was a death scene, actually, death trap scene. And normally, this happened in a split second. Normally, I would have just kind of dismissed the thought and moved on. But because I was in prayer mode, my discernment was keen, and I recognized that it was the spirit of fear attacking mm-hmm. me. And I said, oh, I think it was inspired by the Lord. I said this out loud. Thank God nobody was looking at me. I said, you spirit of evil foreboding, I cast you out in the name of the Lord Jesus. And as soon as I said that, I started belching vigorously,
mm-hmm.
I mean, like, violently. And it was nonstop, and I had this pressure in my abdomen, and I kind of hobbled all the way back. It was almost like a 2-mile journey back to my house.
Mm-hmm.
This thing was like wrenching my gut, and I kept belching and belching and belching, and I kept wrestling with it and casting it out. And I think I got most of it. And then what happened was the following morning there was a little residue. There was like a second installment of that deliverance.
Mm-hmm.
And just as I was waking up in the morning when I was in that kind of twilight state between sleeping and waking, a thought came to me. It was an anxious thought. It was, oh, I'm not going to be able to renew my malpractice liability insurance.
Mm-hmm.
And then, again, a film was, like, played out in my mind, and it was me doing research in the law library, searching for precedents in order to defend myself in court, and me acting as my own attorney, arguing in front of jurors and the judge, pleading my case, basically. I was involved in malpractice litigation. And I said, you spirit of evil foreboding, I told you to get out. I cast you out now.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was belching again, but it wasn't nearly as violent as the day before. And it quickly subsided, and I think that was the last of it.
Mm-hmm.
And it just made me realize that for years now, my creative imagination, my ability to envision things, has been hijacked by the adversary, and he's used that ability to envision, that creative imagination, to weave his own death plot.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been a complete perversion of a gift mm-hmm. that the Lord has given me. And I recognize that familiar spirit in my mother, who, as I said previously, has been a very worried person all of her life. She catastrophizes constantly and, like, dreams up worst-case scenarios. She's actually a survivor of the Hitler regime, World War II survivor. I mean, when she was young, she lost her father on the Eastern Front. She was subjected to air raids. She was malnourished. I mean, yada, yada. And so I think that, she was basically plagued by a spirit of fear from a young age. And it manifested, I recognize that it manifested in her differently. She would verbalize her fear, whereas I would see it.
Imagine it.
Yeah, and I didn't realize that this thing had been plaguing me for years, so I was like a huge revelation.
Mm-hmm. From a dream.
Yeah, from
mm-hmm.
a dream.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you say that you saw these things play out in your mind, mm-hmm. was it just like kind of like your mind running away with you, like you're envisioning it, or are you saying that you actually got a vision?
It was more like a daydreaming type thing.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I did visualize something, but it wasn't like it was an open vision, you know, that people
right.
talk about.
Right.
It wasn't of that quality. It was more like a fantasy being played out.
Mm-hmm. Like your mind got carried away with you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. A thought turned into an actual scene.
And so you recognized it and you arrested those thoughts.
Yeah.
Okay. Good for you. You arrested those thoughts in the sense that by the unctioning of the Holy Spirit, because you were saying you were in prayer mode, you cast out an evil foreboding spirit.
Yeah.
Okay, and then you're saying that this has brought coughing and belching and a little pressure in your abdomen,
mm-hmm.
and it had an effect on you as you walked home.
Yeah.
Okay, and then you had a second episode the next morning, and you believe that that was the last of it.
Yeah.
Okay, all right, that's good. Now, I just want to make a point, after I got your email, and this is just, for you, you may already know this, it was to remind me, or it could be for the listeners, but after I got your email, I was reading, and I wanted to share this with you, Kenneth Hagin's book. Have you ever read The Triumphant Church?
No, but I've heard of it.
Excellent book. Excellent. In this book, he talks about the ways that he held deliverance ministries,
mm-hmm.
and he talked about right things to do and wrong things to do.
Okay.
So if you're open to it, I'd like to kind of share with you what I learned.
Oh, please do.
And it's funny, you know what, Karina? I read this book about 12 or 13 years ago. And the one thing I took from this book and ran with it, because I was younger and more immature in my walk with the Lord, was the thing that I took from it and ran with it was that sickness came from the devil, whether directly or indirectly from the fall, sickness and oppression comes from the enemy. And that's just the thing that stuck out in my mind. We're going back over this book in preparation for this conversation tonight. It's funny how the Lord just brought all these new things to me. And I was like, wow. I didn't remember reading that before. So I'm actually, I was quite enlightened even some more by his book. He's a wonderful teacher. As you know, he's not with us anymore, but he's a legend in my opinion. But in the book, he was talking about right ways and wrong ways to deal with deliverance. And you were correct. He said that when he, and I'm just paraphrasing here, if you want to get the book, it's called The Triumphant Churches by Kenneth Hagin. It's senior, not junior. But he was talking about how in his time of ministry, there were people that were having healing meetings, and they were having loosing meetings, and they were having deliverance meetings and get free meetings. And he said that, well, some of these meetings that he went to learn that people were casting out devils out of people. And he goes into a whole teaching about the division of the soul, the spirit, and the body. So I don't have time to get into that for anybody that may be interested. It's in the book. But he was talking about how people were encouraging the people that were being delivered to have coughing spells. And he was saying how that this one lady was encouraged to have a coughing spell. The preacher went, oh, cough it up, cough it up. And he encouraged her to cough. And he talks about in his book how that particular, even though she didn't have to cough because it wasn't in her, that wasn't a manifestation that this any spirit was showing, but because he was encouraging it, that she started coughing and she started foaming at the mouth. And every day after that, for about 4 months, she'd have to carry around a box of tissues because she was coughing this white frothing stuff out of her mouth. And so the Lord showed Kenneth Hagin that by that preacher ministering to her wrong, she actually opened the door to the enemy by receiving the idea that she had to cough. So he, of course, the whole, you know, moral to the story was he rebuked the enemy in the name of Jesus, and she never frothed again nor needed the box of Kleenex, but he told her to watch out for these style of meetings. The point that he did make on your behalf and in your favor, which is the right way, was that if you have to cough, sometimes that's fine. If there is pressure, that's fine. But it's not something that you want to invite. It's something that should just happen, which is what happened with you, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's great. But another thing that I learned from him that he reinforced was that he talked about in this book how the Word is the main source of warfare. And he gave scripture references about how you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free. And he replaced that word truth with the Word. You shall know the Word, because the Word is the truth, and the Word shall set you free. So he really emphasized on using the Word, as Jesus did when Satan came after him, using the Word as the main foundation. And like I said, there's a lot more detail in this book. I'm just giving like a little overall. But using the Word against a spirit. So in this particular instance, you did what the Holy Spirit unctioned you to do. And he suggested that we always, if the Lord shows us to do something or unctions us to do something, then go with that because we're being led by the Spirit. But there are times that we may not be unctioned to cast something out, and we may just have to apply the Word. And the point that he was making is because the Word always works.
Yes.
Okay, so if it was a spirit of fear, okay.
God has not given me a spirit of fear, but power, love, sound mind, and self-control.
Exactly. The Spirit of the Lord says, or the Word of God says, Karina, God has not given you a spirit of fear, but of love, of power, and of a sound mind. Okay, so you use the Word in that instance, or we should use the Word in that instance. That should be our first choice, unless unctioned by the Spirit to do something differently. And he gave many other examples of right and wrong ways. It was really, really an excellent teaching chapter on deliverance, right things to do and wrong things to do. And so then the second way that he said, unless the Lord unctions you differently, is by the anointing of oil. A lot of times when Jesus, you know, laid hands on somebody, the Spirit left automatically. Okay, or it's the oil, the symbolism of the oil, where the Spirit will leave automatically by the laying on of hands. So there were different things in there, and I just was really glad to see that even though you had a manifestation that the Holy Spirit unctioned you to take that form of deliverance, and it worked.
Yes, yes.
And that's wonderful, to be led by the Spirit like that in your own life through the revelation of a dream and through the power and the authority of the blood of Jesus. And the last thing that I want to emphasize, and I don't know if you did it already or not, and there may be a lot of people that are going through exactly what you went through. You know, we all have different types of oppression, different types of attacks, different types of spirits that will try to come against us, because we all have weak spots, or we can have weak spots if we're not, you know, guarding our territory. But did you replace anything?
Several times a week I will affirm scripture, so probably I did eventually, but I didn't immediately.
Yeah. Whenever you cast a spirit out of your soul realm, always replace it.
Right.
So, you know, after you said, get out of here, you evil, foreboding spirit, in Jesus' name, replace it with the peace of the Lord.
Right.
Lord, in the name of Jesus, God, I just ask that you would come, God, and fill this spot, fill this void, fill this empty part of me, Father, with your peace, God, that surpasses all understanding. God, I just ask that you'd infill me to a greater measure of your Holy Spirit, God. I pray, God, Lord, you know, Jesus said he left his peace with us. You know what I'm saying? My peace I leave with you. And so just pray the opposite of whatever it is that you cast out and replace it. So that's the only thing that I would mention. And that's no matter what it is. If it's sickness and you're casting out a spirit of infirmity, pray. Of course, the blood of Jesus covers you, but pray, you know, for the spirit of health, the spirit of wholeness, the spirit of salvation, you know, because God's salvation is wholeness. But just whatever it is that God has to give, that he gives us, call for more of it. Because the Bible says what about empty spaces?
That the demons return. The demon returns and brings seven others worse than himself.
Yeah.
He finds the house clean and empty and swept.
Yep.
Empty.
Yep.
We want the Lord to occupy.
Yeah. So, of course, that's using his word and his promises, what he gave to us. But that's the only thing that I would suggest.
That's
wonderful. So I'm glad to hear about this.
I am, too, because I'll tell you what. Here's a quirky thing. I thought that my creative imagination had been stunted for years, and I always attributed that to law school. I'd gone through law school and kind of lost interest in fiction and all kinds of things that I used to take pleasure in, and so I just used to chalk it up to, oh, you know, I'm like hyper logical now, but it was actually an evil spirit, and I'm looking forward to seeing how the Lord's going to use my creative imagination, my ability to envision for his glory.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. I think he really, you know, I really think the ability to see can be used by the Lord for us to manifest faith. You know how faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen.
Mm-hmm.
It's like we, at some many points in our lives, we need to see what we believe and, you know, call those things forth that be not as if they were. And
that's exact scripture God just gave me.
Really?
Yes, I just was, as soon as you were finished with that thought, I was going to ask you if I could pray for you.
Woo-hoo.
Praise God. Praise God. So this was a dream, just to close it out, a dream of revelation about where you were at in your walk, something that you were dealing with, even though you didn't know that you were dealing with. It brought the light of what you were fighting or what was oppressing you into, you know, into your head.
Right.
From out of what was in the deep parts inside of you. It brought it into your head. And then the equipping that you have in the Holy Spirit through the blood of Jesus, and you used and you applied God's word, and you were led by the Spirit, and so you won that battle. And this is all an example of dreams, right? And deliverance.
Yes.
That is so great how God was able to do all of that. Now, aren't you glad you're a good student now? I sure am glad you are, because as many people, as much as you helped yourself, you can help others in that same way.
Yeah.
So before you know it, you might be in deliverance.
Well,
isn't that exciting?
It is exciting.
Actually, and you've probably already been dabbling in it, haven't you?
Well, you know, what came to my mind when you were talking about deliverance, even through the, you know, the laying on of hands or the anointing with oil, which is a type of the Holy Spirit. I'm a massage therapist, so I'm laying hands on people a lot and anointing them with oil. You know, they're getting a massage, but I'm beginning to think that the Lord has another dimension here that he wants me to explore, you know?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You know, I can speak from experience in the hairdressing. I have a healing faith. I have a healing anointing in my hands, and people would get healed in my beauty salon. Guy comes to me, he says, I don't know, but every time I come here, my back seems to feel better.
Wow.
God, you know, he needs us in the marketplace. He needs us, you know, praying for the people that we're touching, praying for the people that he's got around us, you know, confessing and transferring that power and believing for them. And, you know, there's a lot of people that I pastored that way. You know, they didn't have their regular, normal church to go to. These are people out in the field with no shepherd that wouldn't even go to a church that God was giving me influence with. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah,
It is. And so I just have to believe that, you know, if God could use a little old hairdresser that way, you know, he can do the same thing for a massage therapist and have, you know, great testimonies of what God can do. And I look back now and it was training ground, part of my training. And you can't get that in college. You see what I'm saying? Or seminary school.
It's God's lab.
It is. So you're in the apprenticeship of the Holy Spirit. And that is absolutely wonderful. I can't wait to hear some great testimonies of people that you massage and who get set free. And it's not going to be in a way that's going to be churchy. It's just going to be like, I don't know what happened. But, you know, I just seem to be okay. But can I just say a short prayer with you?
Oh, I would love it.
Okay. Father God, we just come before you, Lord. We thank you, Father God, for this time of fellowship, Father, this time of sharing, God. I pray, God, for anybody listening, Father God, that they wouldn't be freaked out by this, Lord, but they would be encouraged and strengthened, Father God, and enlightened in how, Father God, you can use a man or a woman in this day and age. In Jesus' name, Father God, Lord, I just right now just ask that the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will come, Father God, and just flood Karina's heart, mind, and soul, and body, Father. Lord, I just declare, as she said earlier, speak things that are not as though they were. I declare those taxes are going to be paid, God. I declare, God, that termite problem is going to be taken care of. I declare, Father God, Lord, that her rent's going to be paid, Father. I declare in the name of Jesus, God, that every one of her bills, Father God, are going to be taken care of, Father, Lord. And I pray, God, that she would be led to ask or to get help or to make money, Father God, in the way, God, that you are leading her to, Father. In Jesus' name, Father God, Lord, I just ask, Lord, if you'd open doors, Father, financial prosperity, Father, whether it's gifts, whether it's work, Father, whether it's royalty checks, wherever you choose to bring it, I pray that you do it, Father, and give her a testimony, God, in the name of Jesus, Father. God, we love you today. We appreciate you, Father, and we thank you for the dream. We thank you for revelations. We thank you for your power, your blood, your death, and your sacrifice and resurrection. And all this is possible, God, Lord, to walk victoriously in and through your Son, Jesus Christ, Father. And we just, God, honor you today, Father, and we're proud to be called ambassadors of the Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I'm your host, God's Girl. If anybody out there has a dream that they'd like to share, or a dream that they'd like help interpreting, or even just a dream that they know and they just want to share their testimony, feel free to send me a short dream on email. My email address is godsgirltv@yahoo.com. Once again, godsgirltv@yahoo.com.
I'm your host, God's Girl, and I'd just like to take the time to tell you that I've got some great news for you today. The news is that Jesus Christ is Lord. If you don't know him, you know who you are. You know that you don't know him. But if that's you and you'd like to know him, just accept Jesus Christ into your heart. Just say, Lord, I believe that you were born of a Virgin Mary, that you are God. I believe you died on the cross for my sins, rose again on the third day, and have the power to give me eternal life. Amen. That's all you got to do is just ask Christ to come into your heart and then turn your whole life over to him. God bless you and welcome to the family.
In Your Dreams theme music is written and produced by Brian Neal.